We invite you to join us for the morning worship service of Trinity on the Hill United Methodist Church. We welcome you as we worship the Lord together.
It is your turn as we read responsively from the call to worship, but today we'll ask you to remain seated as we go into the hymn of praise. There will be a processional of the bells that you will not want to miss. Once we begin singing Christ the Lord is Risen today, you'll be asked to stand at that point. Follow with me now in our call to worship. Christ is risen.
Glory.
Christ is risen from the dead.
Glory.
Christ the Lord is risen today. Christ is risen indeed. Glory, hallelujah.
Thank you.
privilege to affirm our faith in the risen Lord as we join together in using the historical Apostles' Creed. Many of you in here are familiar with the words to the Apostles' Creed, but we want to encourage you all to follow along in the order of worship because the words are the same, but the format is a little different as we celebrate this Resurrection Sunday. Let's affirm our faith together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. On the third day, he rose from the dead. On the third day, he rose from the dead. On the third day, he rose from the dead. And he ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Be seated as we move into our prayer time together. This altar is open. It's a place to pray, but it's not the only place to pray. If you like to approach the altar of your heart where you are, but what a wonderful, wonderful Easter Sunday to be able to use this space. So if it's comfortable for you to do so while we sing through this song, Oh How He Loves You and Me, feel free to come forward to make this your space.
Oh, how he loves you and me.
God of glory and life, we praise you this morning because you have triumphed. In taking on the cross, you have triumphed over sin, and by rising again, you stand victorious over death. We give you praise and thanks for your greatness, and we give you thanks because your victory has now become our victory. Thank you for the gift of your work on the cross and in the resurrection. So many of us today are filled with joy. Today's a day that many of us will spend with friends and family, and we'll worship and we will share a meal, and we'll laugh and we'll remember our shared histories. Thank you, God, for this day of joy and celebration. We are also mindful, God, that not everyone is filled with joy today. We are mindful of those who woke up hungry this morning and will have no Easter meal. We are mindful of those who woke up in hospital rooms this morning. We are mindful of those whose hearts are heavy with any number of problems or worries. We are mindful of those who doubt what we're celebrating today. We are mindful of those whose family meals today won't be pleasant. We are mindful of the people of Sri Lanka and so many others who woke up in war zones today. God, we are mindful, and we are mindful even of our own pain. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. God, help us to be patient. Help us to know when to reach out. Help us to know when to speak and when to stay silent. Help us to be your hands and feet. Help us to see that even when we are sick or afraid or doubtful or worried, that you are with us. You are with us. Emmanuel, God with us. Help us to claim the resurrection power that you offer to each one of us. Help us to see that the resurrection reminds us that the worst thing is never the last thing. The worst thing is never the last thing. Help us, no matter what our situations are today, God, to claim your victory. It's in the mighty and strong name of Jesus Christ we pray, and we pray as he taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
He gave his life. What more could he give? Oh, how he loves you. Oh, how he loves me. Oh, how he loves you and me.
Don't miss this. Crown him with many crowns. Number 327. Let's sing as expectant people of that Easter Sunday. Let us stand.
Thank you.
great time for the children to come down and be with Mike, and you greet one another in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, as we started this broadcast, don't miss this. You know, this wonderful love of Jesus Christ that we celebrate that occasion of His death and resurrection, His resurrection today, is something that can stay with us for our entire lives, every moment of our life. But it takes that initial commitment of justifying grace, of saying yes to Jesus Christ. Yes, Lord, I need You in my life. If you need to make that statement today, if you need help making that statement today, contact us. We would love to talk to you about that. Thank you for watching this broadcast. Thank you for being here, and happy Easter. Bye-bye.
Okay, so it's a big day, right? Easter day. Did anybody get one of these this morning? Yesterday? You got a bigger one than this?
Yeah. Wow,
that's... Wow, that's pretty huge. What'd you find in it? Candy?
I found a lot of eggs.
Were they chocolate? Chocolate eggs? Anybody got a different kind of egg?
A JoJo bow.
Well, I don't think I had one of those when I grew up. Did anybody have kind of like a little stuffed toy in there, maybe? Yeah,
a couple. Yeah.
How about some little games? Anybody have some little games?
Yeah.
No? Oh, you did? You got some little games? That tic-tac-toe? That's good. Easter baskets have come a long way since I was a little boy. So I wanted to come and bring you my Easter basket and show you what I got. So let me get this open for you. Let's see if you can see that. Can you see that? What did I get?
Cracked eggs.
Cracked eggs. Does everybody see that? Can you see that in the back? Cracked eggshells.
That's
boring, right? Why did I get cracked eggshells?
You were bad.
Was I bad?
Yeah.
We might be getting our holidays mixed up.
Maybe you were not obedient.
He
accidentally got his breakfast eggs mixed up.
Breakfast eggs mixed up with my chocolate egg. Maybe that's why my breakfast tasted so good this morning.
Yeah, that's why.
Well, I have a special story to tell you about Easter eggs. This is a whole egg. What's inside of a whole real egg?
A yolk.
And that is a...
We eat
yolks. Oh, you eat yolks. Well, let's back up a little bit more than that, because eggs have inside of them little chickens. Yeah, this is where little chickens come from. So, Mom and Dad, you're going to have a lot of splaining to do at supper. So, there's a little chicken in here, and when it hatches, it's alive, right?
Yeah.
So, think about it this way. The reason that the church decided to have Easter eggs is that this egg looks like a tiny little tomb, a grave, that's keeping the chicken inside, and it can't get out, and it's dark, and it can't see. But on the day that it's born, it busts through the eggshells, and suddenly it's alive, right? Suddenly it's alive. Now, at Easter, what we're celebrating is that Jesus was put in a tomb, a grave. Everybody thought He was dead. But then on the third day of Easter, oh, the eggshells are cracked. And He arose from the dead. All right, let's cheer. Hey, we can say glory. So that's why I got eggshells today, to remind me that Jesus is not in the tomb, but He's alive. And that's why we have Easter, and we celebrate that. So don't feel too sorry for me, okay? I'll find some candy a little bit later, all right? All right, let's pray together. Lord, we thank You that You have risen from the dead and You live even now to be our Savior, and that You watch over us. You forgive us of our sin. You guide us on our ways so that we can be faithful to Your Father, our God. Help us always to obey you, Jesus. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Now, those of you going to children's church will be following Miss Lillian in this direction. Those of you going back to your parents will have to go find them. So moms and dads, if they're coming back to you, stand up so they can find you. All right? We want to make sure they can find you.
My brother saw the Easter Bunny.
Ah, we have a reporting of the Easter Bunny. Be careful. All right, Dino, there you go. This morning in our offerings, we want you to know that so many ministries happen because of your generosity. Just looking in our bulletin this morning, you can see that from not only today, but through the summer, we have such a busy schedule. But it's not just about us within the four walls of the church. It's about our city. It's about our CSRA. It's about our nation and even our world, our earth, as we have missions to other nations. So your offering this morning will go to tell the story of the risen Savior, not just here within the church walls, but around the world. We ask our ushers to come forward as we pray. Our gracious and holy God, we give you thanks for the creation of this world and all the beautiful gifts that come to us through this creation. But we are so thankful for the gift of Jesus Christ, who gave his life to us on the cross as a gift of eternity and forgiveness. But you gave us the gift of resurrection as you raised your Son from the grave, and today we celebrate. Receive now our gifts and our lives to be used in the advancement of this kingdom of the risen Lord Jesus the Christ. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us remain standing as we honor the reading of God's holy word today from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 24. Throughout this season of Lent, we have been studying the parables or the stories that Jesus told on his way to the cross. I have waited for this morning when we could no longer, when we would no longer tell the stories that Jesus told, but we would tell the story of Jesus himself. This is the story of his resurrection. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they didn't find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly, two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. And in their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee. The Son of Man must be delivered over to the hands of sinners, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again." And then the women remembered his words. When they came back from the tomb, the ladies told all these things to the 11 and to all the others. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and even the other women who were with them as they told this to the apostles. But the apostles did not believe the women because their words seemed to them like nonsense. Peter, however, got up and ran to the tomb, and bending over, he saw the strips of linen lying by themselves, and then he went away, wondering to himself what had happened. May the Holy Spirit awaken your curiosity. May the Holy Spirit inspire your understanding and even change your behavior in the reading of God's holy word. You may be seated. Everybody's got a story. Right? Everybody's got a story. I'm not talking about a fabricated story or a lie, like sometimes we use that word. I'm using the word story as it's defined in the dictionary, an account of what happened, kind of like a newspaper story. Everybody's got a story. So today I ask you, what's your story? What is your story? Now I know that sounds like a pickup line from a bar. But it could also be a line of two friends getting to know each other and asking, "What's your story? I'll tell you my story, you tell me your story." Everybody's story is important. Some people have really great stories. You want to listen to them all day long telling stories about their past and what they did, what they said. Then when it becomes your turn, you go, "I got nothing." Your story is just normal, average story, like me. Last Sunday, Augusta was a witness of quite a story, if you remember. Tiger Woods won his first golf tournament in over 11 years as he won the Masters in 2019. And of course, every commentator had to tell us about how he had fallen from the pinnacle of fame to the infamy of a very public revelation of his brokenness, physically, mentally, and spiritually. I remember the commentators talking last week about this accomplishment of winning the Masters was probably the greatest comeback story in any sport, in any sport. And they might be right. But as important as that story is, as important as your story is, and it is important, there is even a greater story. The greatest story ever told. The life and death of Jesus Christ, and if you want to use that phrase, the greatest comeback in history, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It indeed is the greatest story ever told. It took two angels at the tomb to tell the women what was going on. He's not here. He's risen. Why do you keep looking for the living among the dead? It's the greatest story ever told in that it changed the day that we worship. Early in the life of the church, we worshiped on Saturday, the day of creation, of Sabbath rest. But because Jesus was raised on a Sunday, we changed our day of worship to this day. It is indeed the greatest story ever told. And the good news today is it can become your story. It can become your story. But as great as this story is, it almost never got told. It almost did not get told, because the first eyewitnesses to the empty tomb were women. Now, personally, I think it's very appropriate, even providential, that the female gender who stayed at the cross, except for little John, they were the only ones who stayed through the crucifixion, that they are the ones who get to discover the empty tomb first. I'm glad that God would honor these ladies with that privilege of being the first witness. But sadly and unfortunately, in those days, women's testimony were not even accepted in a court of law. And so their only recourse was to go tell the men the story of the missing body. But when the men heard that, it was like they couldn't believe it. Not so much that they didn't believe these ladies who had worked in, up side by side with them with Jesus, but it seemed like it's too horrible to think about someone stealing the body of Jesus. It couldn't be grave robbers. Jesus didn't own anything. Who would be so cruel to steal the body of their friend, their master, their teacher? But Peter goes to see for himself, and sure enough, the body is missing, even though the burial linens are still lying there. And in the Gospel of Luke, it says that Peter went away from the tomb, not quite understanding what was going on. In the Gospel of John, it's Peter and John who go to the tomb and identify the missing, or identify the fact that the body is indeed missing. And in the Gospel of Luke, it says not only did they go away not knowing what was going on, they went home and they locked the doors. They went home and they locked the doors. The greatest story ever told almost died the very day that it broke. I did some research on what makes a good story. You look up all these storytellers and you find out from them what makes a good story. They always say that it's a story that you love to hear over and over again, and it's a story that you want to tell yourself. You want to repeat it to someone else. So the story of the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ is a story that you not only want to love to hear, but it's a story that actually loves you. It actually loves the world. And so when you take that story as your own story, you want to tell the story. That's what makes a good story a great story. And later on in the Gospel of Luke is the chapter we read. It's the last chapter in the Gospel. Jesus will charge his disciples to be the witnesses of this great story. They're to be the storytellers so that the story might be passed to other people. And the reason they were telling that story, as you read that last chapter of Luke, they began to experience the risen Lord themselves. And old Thomas is the one who gets to touch his side and touch his hands. They experienced the risen Lord, and the story became their story. And so the story of the death and resurrection of Jesus has been too great to be contained to any one band of disciples. In the very first chapter of the book of Acts, we see the disciples telling everyone in Jerusalem about this good news of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. After his first sermon, the first Christian sermon in history, over 3,000 people want to be baptized and follow Christ. A little bit later, Peter preaches his second sermon, and suddenly the church is 5,000 and growing with families and children. And it continues to grow within the city of Jerusalem. But the Holy Spirit has more in mind than just a city revived. And so God gives Peter a vision about how this story must be spread, not just to the Jews, but also to those Gentiles, us. You know, those dogs, those Gentiles. And so when Peter finally understands that this is news for everyone, he makes this proclamation in the 10th chapter of Acts. We have become storytellers of everything Jesus did in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. And now we must tell the story to everyone and anyone so that they might believe and trust in the risen Jesus Christ and receive forgiveness of their sins. And while that was going on, God was over here starting another apostle. An unlikely apostle, if you know what I mean. It was Saul. That was his given name. We'd later know him as Paul. Saul was an unlikely candidate for someone who would tell this great story. Why? Because Paul hated the story of Jesus. He hated it so much that he tried to kill or persecute anyone who would believe the story or tell the story. But Paul's heart and soul were changed on that Damascus road when he had a vision himself of the risen Lord. And from then on, Paul would be telling the story in Greece, in Rome, in Italy, in Turkey, and nations all around. The story is too great to be contained in one place. Again and again, the result of sharing the story is that people believe the story, they trust the story, and their lives are changed. They experience for themselves this great story, and they want to tell the story again. And if you know your world history, you know the spread of Christianity as it came through Europe and even through the United States. Sadly, today, in this Western culture, we don't so much like to tell the greatest story ever told. We're more interested in telling our own story, a self-determined story. It's about our truth and not the absolute truth. But yet, this story continues to grow. Christianity is still growing faster than any other time in history. Maybe not here in America, but in what they call the two-thirds world. 60% of the Christians now live in places like Africa, Asia, and Latin America. And in these places, when people believe and trust in Christ and take the story of Jesus to themselves, it is done with great peril. Asian converts to Christ are ostracized by their family and their neighbors. They are persecuted for believing. In China, over 1,000 houses of worship have been demolished. In India, dozens of Christians have been murdered. Their churches have been trashed. One writer who was talking about the persecution of Christians in the two-thirds world said that Christianity has this history of renewing itself, even in the most inhospitable places. But it didn't get into the details of why. Why does it renew itself? Well, I believe it's because the greatest story ever told has a power to transform people. It has the power to change people's souls, their hearts, and even their habits. And because people's hearts and souls are changed, because their habits are changed, the world is able to hear and see for themselves the greatest story ever told, and then they can make that story their own story. Another important characteristic of a good story is that a good story always gets a great response. A good story demands a response, if you will, whether it's emotionally or mentally or even spiritually. A young lady by the name of Lori responded to this story. She had been a nominal church member in her younger days, but when she reached 16, she began to mix with the wrong crowd. She began experimenting with drugs and alcohol. She began to live a life of being stoned, more days than not. Her eyes were glazed. Her voice was always thick. Her skin was pale. In spite of the concern of her family and some of her church friends, she continued on this destructive course. And being so caught up in this drug lifestyle, she never thought she would reach 20. She had no plans for her future. She didn't think she had one. But one very dark, dark day, when she was at the bottom of the bottom, she remembered a story about Jesus. The one that she had rejected as a young child. But because she was so desperate, things were so dark, she verbally yelled out a prayer, "Jesus, why don't you come close to me?" And just as clear inside her soul, she heard Jesus answer, "Lori, I can't come any closer to you because I'm with you. Turn around. Just turn around." And she did. And in that moment, she was overcome with the thoughts of infinite patience, unlimited love, and powerful grace to break the bonds of her sin and her bondage. And she said, even though I rejected him 100 times, he was with me still. That's when I knew that Jesus was not some religious thought, but that he was a risen Savior, a living Lord. And I accepted him. I accepted him as my Savior. His story became my story, and he helped me rewrite my story and my ending. Because it brought her new life. Because the greatest story is her story. So that leads us back to the question we started with. So what's your story? What's your story? The reason that the death and resurrection of Jesus is the greatest story ever told is because when you experience the living Savior, you become a part of his story. Paul put it this way in Romans chapter 6. If we died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with Christ. For we know that since Christ was raised from the dead, he cannot die again. Death no longer has mastery over him. The death he died to sin once and for all. But the life he lives to God. And so in the same way, count yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Jesus Christ. That phrase sound familiar to you? It's the one we used on the beginning of Lent at Ash Wednesday as we put the mark of the cross on your forehead at this altar. We said, count yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. Through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, we can discover a new life in God. Perhaps you've known this story all along, but you've never let that story become your story. Maybe you've tried to keep your story separate from Christ's story because you wanted to write how things would happen. How's it going? Today is a wonderful day to submit your story to the greatest story ever told, to surrender your plot line to the one that God can write for you. A much more fulfilling storyline, and it's an ending, a wonderful ending that has no end. Let us pray. Gracious and holy God, for those of us who are still writing our own story, help us today to surrender to Christ, to allow his story to rewrite our story, and to give us a new life and a new ending. Together with the risen Lord, help us to really live the life that you created for us in the very beginning. And we pray this in the name of the risen Lord, our risen Savior, Jesus Christ. And all God's people said, Amen. For our closing today, I would like for you to refer back to your bulletin. The call to worship shall also be our benediction, our blessing together, as we read responsively. At the end of that benediction, the choir is going to lead us in the Hallelujah Chorus, which is written in your bulletin. You're feel free to join along with us if you would like. We will remain standing through the end of that, and once we get to the end, then you will be dismissed. Join with me now in the call to worship. Christ is risen.
Glory.
Christ is risen from the dead.
Glory. Hallelujah.
Christ the Lord is risen today. Christ is risen indeed. Glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.